Hey, while you're sitting down, if you want to grab one of the outlines in your program today, it'll have our several different texts that we're going to look at in the book of Psalms, and I think you'll find it helpful to have with you those texts. You know, whether you're familiar with the Bible or not, almost everybody is familiar with a Bible character named David. And I think when most people think of David, they think of one of these. They think of that young shepherd boy who took a stone like this, loaded it in a slingshot, and aimed it perfectly, and took down a giant named Goliath. And in fact, that story is so familiar to us that it's even worked its way into the American vocabulary. For instance, if an individual is suing a giant corporation, the people in the news media will talk about it as it's like, you know, David suing Goliath. Or a month from now, during March Madness, during the NCAA basketball tournament, college basketball, the greatest sport on planet Earth, there will be all kinds of, in the first and second round, you know, little schools going up against big school giants, and they'll refer to it as David versus Goliath. In fact, I've often wondered what the battle of David and Goliath might have sounded like if it was reported by a ring announcer at a world heavyweight championship fight. Maybe it would sound something like this.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Valley of Elah Arena for today's heavyweight battle. Let's get ready to rumble! I could use a little encouragement.
Y'all ready for this?
Introducing first the challenger out of the Hebrew camp. He stands at 5'2" tall. He weighs 110 pounds, dripping wet. He's a poet, a musician, a man known after God's own heart. Let's put our hands together for the man in the white tunic, David! His opponent, fighting out of the Philistine camp, standing 9'9" tall, weighing 438 pounds. He brings a record of 92 wins and no defeats, all victories coming by decapitation. Let's put our hands together for the behemoth, Goliath! Well, it should be a very short bout. The giant has a four-reach advantage on the Hebrew hillbilly named David. We appreciate his commitment. We know he loves God, but come on, David, you're just a boy. Oh, wait a minute. Don't do it, David. David's picking up a stone. Oh, no, David, no. He's going to get really mad if you do that. He's putting it in a sling. David's letting it fly. It's right between the eyes. The giant is down. Ding, 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 ding. We have a new world heavyweight champion, the Hebrew kid from Canaan, David!
The things I let myself get talked into around here. Now, friends, when most of us think of David, we think of this little stone. And indeed, that was a remarkable moment. But I believe an even better symbol of David's life, and one which is lesser celebrated, but I think probably much more important, knee pads. Because David was an uncommon prayer. David was one of these guys who fell on his knees and went to deep places with God. Now, we know him, you know, for the guy that slew Goliath. We know him for his infamous act of adultery with Bathsheba. We know him as a great military general. But David was also a great prayer. And he prayed below the surface prayers. Now, most of us pray. Newsweek magazine did a survey and found that 78% of us pray at least once a week. 51% of us pray at least once a day. And get this, even 1 in 5 atheists say they pray at least once a day. I guess it's like the guy who was asked, are you really and honestly an atheist? He said, honest to God. Many of us pray at least on a semi-regular basis, but there's something about David's prayers that set his prayers apart from our prayers. For instance, let me just give you this example, show you what I mean. Oh, hi, I'm Gene. What's your name? Nice to meet you. What do you do? Oh, you're a contractor. That's great. Me? Oh, I'm a pastor. Yeah, I know other people don't believe it either. Yeah, a church called Eastside. Oh, you've heard of us, yeah. How many kids do you have? Two, is that right? My wife and I, we've got three. A lot of fun, a lot of challenge, isn't it? Nice talking to you. Now, what have I just described? I've described a typical conversation in the life of Gene Apple that happens hundreds of times in the course of my lifetime and probably happens in the course of your lifetime too. And it's just surface level. Rarely do those kinds of conversations go below the surface, go to the deep stuff. But that's what sets David's prayers apart from many of ours. Many of our prayers are just surface level stuff with God, and we say our little lines and we offer our little prayers, and rarely do our prayers go to the deep end. Rarely do we need a set of these in order to pray our prayers. And today, all I want to do with you is I want to examine five of some very uncommon prayers, below the surface prayers that David prayed. And it's my hope and my prayer today that after studying these prayers, you'll go in your prayer life to maybe a place that you've never been before, or a place that you haven't been in your prayer life in a very long time. Now, to help you latch onto these, I've put each of these prayers in just simple two-word sound bites. And the first kind of prayer that David prayed below the surface was what we'll just call a why me prayer. Why me? Sometimes in life you go through tremendously difficult circumstances. Your friends try to encourage you and they say, cheer up, things could get worse. So you cheer up and sure enough, things get worse. Because life is full of heartbreaks and problems and losses and accidents and disappointments and more. And in those moments when it happens to you, it's hard not to wonder, why me? Why did this happen to me? And it's easy to get disappointed with God. Now, how do you pray in a moment of devastation? How do you pray when the routine physical turns into your worst nightmare? How do you pray when you try and you can't conceive? How do you pray when you've been waiting to adopt for 7 years and it's about to happen and at the last minute it all falls through? How do you pray when the job that you knew you were perfect for goes to someone else? Or when your fiance sends you the Dear John text message? How do you pray when your workplace goes through restructuring and you get restructured right out of your role, your position, your job? How do you pray in moments like that? I'll tell you what some people do. They spin on their wheels and they thumb their noses at God and they say, God, I've had enough with you. I'm done with you. I'm done with your son. I'm done with your word. I am never going to walk into another church building in the course of my life. I am just done spiritually. Others just start relating to God in a much more guarded fashion. They just never fully trust God again. They never fully engage wholeheartedly in their faith again. They say, God, hey, you deceived me once, but no more. I'm a smart guy. I may have been born at night, but it was not last night. And then others respond by just spiritually faking their way through it. And they paste on a fake hallelujah anyway smile. And they inauthentically say, well, praise God anyway, this terrible thing has happened, but no, it's not been a challenge to my faith. Praise God, hallelujah, let's just praise God. You know, Bible says all things work together for good for those who love the Lord. And a three-year-old can see through their deception. Do you know what David did when he went through these times? He did what many of us are unwilling to do, and he prayed a painfully honest, why me prayer. He just goes off on God. He doesn't pray a sanitized, now I lay me down to sleep, party line, safe prayer. Look at Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why do you remain so distant? Why do you ignore my cries for help? Why me? Why me? Every day I call to you, my God, but you do not answer. Every night you hear my voice, but I find no relief. Our ancestors trusted in you, and you rescued them. Oh, God, you're great to everybody else. You heard their cry for help. You saved them. They put their trust in you and were never disappointed. But me, I'm a worm, not a man. I'm scorned and despised by all. Now, that's not your typical prayer, is it? There's a whole group of psalms that David wrote that are known as Psalms of Lament, where he just pours himself out to God. And I guess one of the reasons that I love the Psalms of Lament so much is that they're just so shockingly real. These psalms teach us how to express our raw, unedited disappointments with God, how to dispense of all the polite, positive God talk. God doesn't want tame, sanitized, dishonest prayers. He wants us to talk to him authentically from our hearts. And sometimes that means raising your voice at God. Sometimes that means using words that you wouldn't repeat in public, especially you wouldn't say in church. The Psalms of Lament teach you how you can love God and express hatred toward God at the same time. And you know what you'll discover as you study David's why me prayers like this? Is that God can handle them. And after that kind of outburst, after that brutal, honest, below the surface praying, God begins to bring perspective to your life. David gets this out of his system. And you see, what's true in our relationships with each other is also true in our relationship with God. You know, a phrase we often say around here is, revealing your feelings is the beginning of healing. And it's an amazing thing. David prays this why me prayer. I mean, he reveals his feelings to God. And the net effect was it helped him move into a healthier perspective about life and about faith. And about the fact that God didn't promise a pain-free life here on earth. He promises that in the life to come. And amazingly, the same guy, think about this, the same guy who prays this why me prayer, this brutal prayer in Psalm 22, turns around and in the very next Psalm 23 writes, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." That's what he's promised me. Some of you who've run from God, or you've gotten guarded in your relationship with God, or you've painted on that fake hallelujah smile over difficult circumstances, you need to pray a why me prayer, because revealing your feelings is the beginning of healing with God, and God can handle those prayers. Now, another kind of uncommon, below the surface kind of prayer is the search me prayer. Search me. A search me prayer is a dangerous prayer because it's the kind of prayer where we open ourselves up for correction from God. It's the kind of prayer where we open ourselves up to be changed by God. A search me prayer says, God, shine the searchlight of your Holy Spirit into the dark recesses of my soul and help me see things in there that shouldn't be there. Search me. Notice David prays in Psalm 139. He says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting." Now, what's interesting about this prayer that David prayed is the context in which he prayed it. Let me share with you an experience from my life to kind of give you a similar sense of the context in which he prayed this. One day, I was driving down like a six-lane road. It was a beautiful day, had the windows down. I come up to a red light, I stop, and there's this car that pulls up right next to me. And it's a 1970 era's Camaro, and it's all beat up, you know, and the trim pieces are missing on the body, and there's no hubcaps, and, you know, body work needs to be done, and it's just, it sounds like this, boom, 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 it sounds just like this, and the stereo's blaring in the car, and it's staring, you know, blaring so much, you know, my car is now shaking with the boom, 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 and the stereo blaring and everything like that. So I look over, and there's two girls in their early 20s in the car, and I guess early 20s, and I mean, they were two of the hardest, like, world-worn girls I had seen in a long, looked like they'd done 45 years of living in their 20-year-old bodies, and, you know, they were dirty, and their hair looked like, you know, maybe it had been shampooed once in the last year, and they both had cigarettes hanging out of the corner of their mouth, kind of looked like they'd been surgically implanted or something, right into the corner of their lip. Now, and here was my thought. I'm over here, boom, 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 boom. And I look over, and I'm not proud of this. I looked over and I thought, I thought to myself, come on, girls, get a life. And friends, I'm not kidding you. Just as soon as that thought entered my mind, it was like the Holy Spirit shot a dart right into me and said, Gene, who do you think you are? Those girls matter to me every bit as much as you matter to me. I love those girls every bit as much as I love you. And I'm telling you, right there at a red light that day, I said a search me prayer. And I realized I had some attitudes. I had some pride issues. I have some lack of love in me that I need the searchlight of God's Holy Spirit to shine that needed to be dealt with. It was that kind of scene that led David to pray this uncommon prayer in Psalm 139. Earlier in this psalm, in this prayer, David is praising God. And he's worshiping. And as he's praising God, he starts thinking about all the people in the world that don't love God and don't follow God and don't worship God. And he's thinking about that. It ticks him off. And he was feeling pretty smug, pretty self-righteous about himself. And then all of a sudden he thinks, oh no, what am I doing? Worrying about the rebelliousness of others when I still have so many dark spots in my own heart. So he says, search me, O God. Know my heart. See if there is an offensive way in me. And deal with those rough edges. If you want to go deep in your spiritual journey, I'm going to tell you right now, it takes some search me prayers. God, search me and help me see what it is that's preventing me from fully taking up my cross and following you. God, are there attitudes that need adjustment? Are there memories that need to be let go of? Is there sin or dishonesty or immorality or habits or attitudes or hurts that I'm refusing to deal with? Search me, God. Expose it to me. Help me to see it for what it really is. Now, friends, don't pray that kind of prayer unless you're humble enough to receive the answer. But I can assure you this, if you don't build this prayer habit, you will never break your sin habits. Let me say that again. If you don't build this prayer habit of search me kind of prayers, you will never break your sin habits. Now, often the search me prayer leads us to the third kind of below the surface prayer, and that's forgive me. Forgive me. Probably next to slaying Goliath, the most well-known event from David's life is his committing of adultery with the beautiful married woman named Bathsheba. One night, David's out in his palace on the veranda. He looks outside and across the way. He sees a beautiful woman naked taking a bath on her roof. I've never been able to figure out what she was doing taking a bath. I don't know where you take baths at your house. We don't take them on our roof. And he's captured by her beauty, and he sends for her. And she spends the night, and they sleep together, and she conceives. And she becomes pregnant. David's got a problem on his hands. And so he sends her husband, who is one of his warriors serving in his army, into the front lines of a battle on a suicide mission. Kills him. Uriah is gone. And before Uriah's body is even cold, David marries Bathsheba. He thought he had pulled off the perfect crime. He thought he had concealed his sin from everybody. Nearly a full year passes. And he's got Bathsheba, and they have their baby, and everything's going along fine until a friend shows up named Nathan, his closest friend. And Nathan tells David a story about a rich man and a poor man who lived in the same town. The rich man had large flocks of sheep and cattle. The poor man had only one prized, unblemished, perfect lamb who his family loved. And it was so close to the family, the kids interacted with it. This sheep even shared their meals with him. That's how close they were. Well, one day, the rich man has company, and instead of killing one of the lambs from his giant flock, he goes to the poor man and takes the only lamb that he has, that prize lamb, and he kills it. Well, this story infuriates David. And he screams, "This is outrageous. This is unthinkable. This man deserves to die. Who is this man, Nathan?" And Nathan says, "You're the man, David." Now, this was not a good thing. This was not like a "you to man, David." Okay, that's not what he's saying. He says, "You're the man. God blessed you in every way imaginable. He took you from shepherd boy to a king. You've got palaces. You've got popularity. You've got power. And you had to take the one thing that Uriah had, his beautiful wife. You're the man, David." Well, that pierced David's heart. And he sees himself for who he really is, a liar, an adulterer, a deceiver, a murderer. And David was a broken man. And he sees himself in need of forgiveness. And it was that setting that led him to pray this "forgive me" classic prayer in Psalm 51. "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me." Do you know what I'm wondering right now? I'm wondering who among us right now is going through life like David did for about a year there, just wearing a mask, just hiding, pretending that everything is okay. I wonder who's the man, who's the woman who's carrying secret sin right now, and you need to take off your mask. I wonder who has the substance abuse issue that they can't admit. I wonder who's cheating in school, who's stealing from the business, who's all tangled up with pornography. I wonder who's committing sexual sin. I wonder who's committing adultery right now. Who's the man? Who's the woman? I wonder who needs to come clean to God today and say, "Have mercy on me, O God. Forgive me." You know what? God looked down on David's heart and he saw the sincerity of his prayer. He saw that this was not just a "help me get out of a bind" prayer, but this was a "God, I am so sorry." And he was contrite and he was repentant and God forgave his sin. And today, by God's grace in your life through Jesus Christ, your sin could be forgiven too and you could be cleansed. Listen, you are just one prayer away from a totally different life. One prayer away from a totally different life. You can live in denial and you can let your heart get hard. Or you can fall to your knees and open your heart and pray the "forgive me" prayer. Now, this fourth prayer is a prayer that I bet we've all prayed one time or another, and it's just simply, "Help me. Help me." Let me ask you, have you ever had a day where you felt like this woman? Look at this picture going to come up on the screen. Had a bad day like that? She's still smiling. Got her keys in her car right here. I've often looked at this picture and I thought, you know, wonder how the conversation was when she called her husband that day and told her, you know, she's got the wedding ring on. I can see right here. Wait a minute. And then I got to thinking, what if this was her husband's boat? Now, we've all had those days, you know, it's just a bad day. And we go into our quiet place of prayer and we lift up our voices to God and cry, "Help! Help! Help me!" Now, the help me prayer often grows out of the same circumstances as the why me prayer, but it's different because when you get to help me, you're past the point of just going off on God for not doing things the way you would. Now you're praying for God to give you the grace, to give you the power, to give you the strength in the circumstance that you're in. Maybe you've already prayed for God to take you out of the circumstance and he's not taking you out, so you got to pray for help while you're in the circumstance. You pray what David prayed in Psalm 70. He says, please, God, rescue me. Come quickly, Lord, and help me. Please hurry to my aid, O God. You are my helper and my savior. When our girls were 3 and 5 years old, one Friday morning, we were living in Vegas. I was in my office, and I was on the phone. It was about 11:30 in the morning, and I saw another call was coming in on a different line, but I was on a call, so I just let that call go over to voicemail, and I finish the call, and I hang up and listen to my voice message, and it's my wife, Barbara, and I heard a tone of panic in her voice that I had never heard in my life. And she said, it's me, I'm with the girls, we're next to Ross Dress for Less, there are guns firing, people are on the ground, I've got the girls laying on the floor of the van, I don't know what I should do, call me, bye. I picked up and dialed her cell phone so fast, and what am I praying while I'm dialing? God, help. Help Barbara, help the girls. I don't know what's going on, but help. They were right in the middle of a vicious double homicide of 2 armored truck guards, laying cold blood right on the pavement outside the van. And all we could do was cry for help. Some of you are right in the middle of circumstances right now where you know you are not big enough. You're not. But God is big enough. He's big enough for the challenges you're facing in your life. He's big enough for the strength that you need to care for that family member right now that has such demanding needs. He's big enough for the emptiness that you feel in your soul. He's big enough for the roadblocks that you have in your finances. He's big enough for the wisdom that you need as a parent. He's big enough for the challenges that we face as a church. He's big enough to provide you strength for your body and mind and soul that are so weary. God is big enough. Now, God may choose not to change your circumstances. He did that for the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul prayed 3 times for God to remove a physical affliction, and instead, God didn't do that. God said, I'm going to give you the strength that you need. My power will be made perfect in your weakness, Paul. And God will give you the help you need, and the grace you need, and the strength you need to make it too. Friends, God loves it when his kids come to him and pray, help me. Now, there's one final prayer that David shows us how to pray, and it's a risky prayer. It's not for the spiritually faint of heart. It's simply a prayer that says, lead me. God, take my life, take my future, take my time, take my energy, take my resources, and I want you to lead me. Now, this is not a prayer for those of you that want to play in the shallow end with your floaties on and paddle around the pool, okay? This is the kind of prayer that you pray for those who want to go to the deep end spiritually in your life. This is a prayer for those who are really serious about being uncommon people and living uncommon lives. Notice David prayed a lead me prayer in Psalm 61. He says, from the ends of the earth, I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Lead me. How long has it been, or honestly, has there ever been a time in your life where you have strapped on some knee pads and you have fallen on your face before God and you've said, okay, God, I am opening myself up to you right now. Lead me. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Friends, listen, those who pray like that write history. Those who don't pray like that read history. Our date with death is not determined by a date on a tombstone. It is the day we stop praying, lead me prayers. You know what keeps many of us from praying, lead me prayers? I'll tell you what it is. It's the fact that we don't know where God is going to lead us when we pray them. We're afraid to pray for God to lead us because we think we know what's best for our lives and not God. We don't believe that we could matter so much to God that he could put together a plan for our lives that is better than anything that we could conceive of ourselves. But that, friends, just really shortchanges the character of God. And if we're afraid to pray the lead me prayers, we're going to miss out on God's best plans for us. We're going to miss out on spiritual adventures. I've told many of you before about what a defining day it was when my father died when I was 14 years old of a heart attack. I won't go into the whole story right now, but I had the sense that day that God was saying to me, Gene, what happened to your dad today is going to happen to every single person on the face of the earth. One day will be their last. And there's only one thing that matters on that day. Do they know my son, Jesus Christ? Do they know grace? And I just sense God saying, if you'll put your hand in my hand, if you'll trust me, I'm going to use your life to help people get ready for their last day and to live every day in between. And so that day, as a 14-year-old in northern Minnesota, I prayed the lead me prayer. God, lead me. You know, that night I had a vision of Southern California beaches and palm trees and Disneyland. No, not really. See, the point of the matter is when you pray a lead me prayer, you have no idea where God's going to lead. You have no idea. You don't know when he's going to lead. You don't know how he's going to lead. You don't know where he's going to lead. You don't know what you're going to be doing in the midst of that. I had no idea. I couldn't see East Side in my future one day. I just prayed, God, lead me. And the reason I feel so sad for people who never pray lead me prayers is that I know firsthand where lead me prayers can take you. In fact, I wonder what my life would look like right now if I hadn't started praying lead me prayers on a regular basis back in 1974. I would have missed out on so many adventures of faith that God has given me the privilege of being a part of in my lifetime. I would have missed out on this adventure called Eastside. I would have missed out on all of you watching God work in your lives, watching people grow, watching people serve, watching people unleash compassion in this world. I love this church. I love all of you. I could have just missed it all without praying a lead me prayer. Lead me prayers are dangerous prayers. They really are. But I'll tell you something more dangerous than praying a lead me prayer is not praying a lead me prayer. In a couple of weeks, we're going to start our Lent experience, 40 days in the Word, and for 6 weeks, we are going hard after God, and we are going to dig deep, and we are going to open up ourselves to the work of His Spirit among us in fresh ways. Just imagine what would happen in us, what would happen in our own spiritual journey if we followed David's example during this time, and we started praying lead me prayers. I wonder who among you God might use to meet the needs of the forgotten, the homeless, the poor, if you just had the courage to pray a lead me prayer. I wonder who among you might feel led to help on some of our international projects, to help lift people out of poverty and to develop skills and education and businesses and hope and faith, if you had the courage to pray a lead me prayer. I wonder who might feel led to shift careers, to take a pay cut, to change college majors, to courageously go on a new path that they lead God, feel God calling them to. I wonder who among you in the future might lead a connection group and might become that source to help people find that place to belong, to grow spiritually, and to serve in their life, whether it's with children or students or adults. We have some affluent people among us. God's blessed you with much, and I just wonder how many of you might go on an adventure of generosity and experience needs that you could meet and lives that you could affect. How many of you could help change this church and mark this church in staggering ways if you just had the courage to pray a lead me prayer? I wonder who has the courage among us today to pray a lead me prayer and then trust God for the adventure. Past Thursday morning, I had a big day on Thursday. It was just kind of one of those busy days from start to finish, and I knew it was going to be a big day ahead, so I got up early and had my shower and had breakfast, and I kissed Barbara and the girls goodbye, and I walked out into the garage, and I got into my car, and my car wouldn't start. My battery was dead. And You know, it wouldn't go because it didn't have its power. Couldn't start. It didn't have the power to go. And if you would look at my car, I'm one of those guys, you know, I like a clean car. I keep my car clean inside and out. You say, man, it's a good-looking car, man, looking nice, you know. I got French fries all over my car. Your car looks clean. And you'd say, it looks good. And that's all it does. It looks good because it wasn't going anywhere. It had lost its power. You know, I got to thinking about how a lot of us, when we come in here on the weekend, we come in, you know, we look, you know, semi-good. And, you know, we carry our Bibles and we look like we got it together. And some of you serve on Sunday and you're in connection groups and things like that. But, you know, if God could look down, you know, he could like put a little spotlight on each person who's missing their power. Because we don't spend enough time here. And that's our power source. Now, a lot of people, when they think of David, they think of that rock. I hope in the future you'll think of these, some knee pads. In fact, I got to thinking, wouldn't it be something if over the course of time, when people thought of Eastside, they didn't think of, you know, hey, that big church moving out to that former Boeing site in Anaheim, you know, but they said, well, that's the church where people, they get on their knees and they pray and God shows up and he does extraordinary things because they have the courage to be dangerous in their prayers.